I want to thank everybody for turning out like this. When I go to the Northeast, when I go to the West Coast, people up there do not understand why we are so outraged. Why are we so many atheist activists in the South? Right? Yeah. And they have a very, you know, kind of lackadaisical idea of just, you know, let people believe what they want to believe, and that's fine. It's not about what people want to believe. It's about what they want to enforce on other people. And I fear that with this new administration, that when I go to the Northeast states now, or let's say 6 months from now, I will no longer have to explain the necessity of why we are so polarized about this in the South, where everybody representing every level of government is all about right-wing, you know, dominionism and imposing their beliefs on other people. Where's the...
You don't want to do Brandon's presentation again?
Yeah, that's another thing. Why did you put me behind these guys? Because these guys killed. Yeah, well, you're going to be so disappointed because that last guy was much better than me. All right, so they mentioned the Phylogeny Explorer Project, and a lot of people ask, what is that, right? And it's especially funny when they introduce me and they usually can't pronounce it because somebody said it was the Phalange Explorer Project. It's a completely different connotation, isn't it? And I used this finger on purpose. Okay, so once upon a time, everybody thought that, is it working? Okay, good. Everybody thought that everything was animal, mineral, or vegetable. Anybody heard this colloquialism before, right? Okay, this is something that only works in English, not in ancient Greek. So we're only talking about, we're not just talking about, you know, ancient civilizations, but, you know, very simple sort of people that haven't obviously investigated this any further than that. Not long ago, I had a debate with a Muslim creationist who criticized me for saying that you can establish a hierarchy using the simple rules of Sesame Street's game, one of these things is not like the other, right? But animal, mineral, or vegetable, one of these things is not alive. So we already have parent categories determined that way by whether something is living or dead. And centuries ago, there was no understanding that living things were also made out of minerals, and that, you know, being the physical components that may or may not have been part of a living thing at some point. And a lot of people think that the mineral category exists in four divisions already. So we have a subdivision just of the minerals now. Now, it can't be this simple, right? Earth, wind, fire, water. I never understood what they meant by that, because, I mean, ancient people understood that there was more divisions. They understood about gold and silver, right? They clearly understood the difference between gold and lead, you know, salt and things like this. All of the things that would be in the earth category. So we have another subdivision, systematic classification. So maybe, if you want to do any apologetics for this idea, maybe they were talking about this. All right, so they have the four states of matter. That could have been what they were talking about, if we take plasma and tone down the temperature a little bit down to fire. Because obviously people in ancient times wouldn't have any concept of anything being heated to millions of degrees. Plasma is a fourth state of matter that wasn't determined until the 19th century, or excuse me, the 1900s. And that information still hasn't made it into many of our schools. But maybe that's what they were talking about, you know, the liquid, solid forms and so forth. But even if that is what they meant, and it probably is, it's still a little confusing because there was a fifth element that wasn't related to the temperature of a substance, but to whatever mystical matrix the planets moved through. So, for example, some people have interpreted this to be spirit, right? And so they have these spirits infusion that ancient scientists, well, I was saying ancient, so I'm going back to the Enlightenment, let's say the 1600s, the 1700s, into the 1800s, scientists thought about things very differently than what modern scientists do. They were very superficial. They looked at surface features, which we'll talk about in a moment. One of the things that they thought, for example, was that the reason things burn is because they were infused with a thing called phlogiston. It's a mystery substance they couldn't figure out how to detect, and that when they had carbon left over from burning wood, it's because the carbon is what's left after the phlogiston has been liberated from it. Okay. This was a serious scientific theory before they figured out how a theory should work. Nowadays, a theory is a completely different concept. Very effectively, a theory now has to be, is a hypothesis once proven becomes a theory. That's a colloquial sense. It's not the way that scientists talk about it, but the way laymen think about it was probably accurate. In order to qualify as a theory now, you effectively have to prove it before it reaches that level of confidence. So I was talking about phlogiston, and one of the things that they thought about life was that life had this fifth element in it, this ether, this essence of being, and that when something died, the life force that animated it was still there. They weren't thinking of terms of a soul that would leave. This was some separate kind of a concept. That when the body rots, and not just bodies, but anything that was alive, whether it's rotting vegetables, you know, meat going bad, or even feces, anything that was once alive had life force still in it. And that as the organic matter decayed, the life force also decayed. And they thought that it would ebb out. They called it an evanescent essence, or what was it? It was considered like a vapor. The same thing as spirits, like when you open a bottle of alcohol and you look and you see the air distortion. I mean, this is what they call spirits, right? This is the evaporation. So they thought that life is evaporating out. And it has an effect on the surrounding area. So that anything that was once alive, anything at all, even crap, would emanate something, and they could tell that there was something emanating from it. And they got the idea that this life force in close proximity to the rotting material would all have an adverse effect, that supernaturally the life force would conjure mold, bacteria, maggots, vile forms of, you know, this putrefied life force would create putrefied life as it goes bad and emanates out. And this is the concept of spontaneous generation. This is what, what's his name? The scientist, 1859, what's his name? Louis Pasteur. I had to look to my notes, sorry. Okay, so this is what he disproved, was spontaneous generation, the idea that anything that dies really, you know, emanates this life force. This is not remotely the same thing, or even similar to abiogenesis, which is the concept of how life emerges through successive stages through a prior matrix and how this has to be modified and everything. So if you were to look this up, if you look up either of these words in any mainstream dictionary, they all say that these are both the same thing. Matter of fact, if I looked it up on Merriam-Webster and looked it up on dictionary.com, they both say that spontaneous generation is the disproved theory from the 19th century that life can form from non-life, which is not what spontaneous generation says, because it's not coming from non-life. And it's not what abiogenesis says, because abiogenesis was never disproved. But you can't get people to correct themselves, not when they want to control what is being believed. So, it's like that line out of Futurama. I don't understand evolution, and I have to protect my kids from understanding it. It's not just what they don't know, it's what they won't know, what they don't want to understand. And it has been said that false knowledge is more dangerous than ignorance, because it's not just what they don't know, it's what they also think they know, right? So the last time that I came to Florida to give a Darwin-Day presentation, I talked about how there was this hypothesis from early, I want to call them scientists, they were what they had before they were scientists. People were speculating that the reason that people in the North were a different color than the people in the South was because of how much more or less blood they had, to give you an idea. People were otherwise very superficial. There was a belief in Europe in the Middle Ages into the Renaissance that if you adopt the clothing and behavior of a thing, you could become that thing. For example, berserkers, the Viking berserkers, the Norse, would put on the shirts of bears to absorb their strength, right? And there was a ritual that went along with that. And the Teutonic Vargr did exactly the same thing, but with the hides of wolves. So berserk means bear sark, a shirt of made of bear fur, right? So berserk, bear shirt, right? Whereas the Teutonic Vargr would literally werewolf, werewolf, That's literally where that came from. Okay, so there used to be this ritual practice where they would become wolves if they just dress like wolves and act like wolves and think like wolves. So it's a combination of self-hypnosis, you know, how religion can do that, right? And then, you know, sometimes mixed with some drugs. They played with every kind of mushroom. And if you saw this, I mean, culturally now we see this as like, you know, some kind of ritual magic that people traditionally believed in. But if you went back in time and you watched this in action, it would look like grown-ups playing pretend, but taking it deadly serious. Okay, so this superficial belief also translates into the way that they used to classify life forms, being very superficial about it. And we're going to take a look at the way the Bible classifies life forms. So if you compare Jonah to Matthew, then whales and fish are the same thing. Although, I have seen people defending the Bible argue that the word here doesn't mean whale or fish, that it actually means sea monster. So now the story's completely more reasonable, right? And even in the Age of Enlightenment, whales were referred to as breathing fish. Because again, we would classify things by what they did, not what they are. And according to Deuteronomy, bats are birds because they can fly. And according to one interpretation of Leviticus, and this may be my own alone, I haven't come across anybody else that reads it this way, is that bats might also be locusts because they are they're crawling things that also swarm, and they go about on all fours. And people get all confused. Why would they call locusts? Why would you say that you're forbidden to eat the locust that runs about on all fours when locusts have six legs? I think they're talking about bats because they classify things by what they did. And notice that you can, you're not allowed to eat carrion eaters, but they don't have a parent category for carrion eaters. You can't eat, you can eat owls, but only of those species. If you find another species that isn't on the list, you have to assume that you can't eat it. Why? Because it's not on the list. You know, for literally no reason at all. And notice also that it mentions ostriches here, because ostriches can't fly. And that's important for the way that non-scientists or creation scientists classify life forms. They have their alternate means of taxonomy called baraminology. And so the fact that ostriches can't fly right at the get-go, right from the moment of creation, before they even get on the ark, we have multiple different kinds of birds, right? And the types that don't fly are important, like the penguins that aren't in the Bible because the biblical authors didn't know about them. So the idea of baraminology is this creationist concept where they will accept that certain degrees of evolution happen because it's too obvious to deny. Things like, you know, dogs, for example. Other sorts of speciation events, when they were forced to accept that speciation actually happens and that that's technically macroevolution, but they're not going to call it that, so they push the boundary back, right? Push the goalpost back to beyond the genus level, to the family level, or something like that, wherever necessary. As a matter of fact, Ken Ham of Answers in Genesis admits that he will push that boundary back to different places for different lineages however he sees fit. Just to keep their belief system intact. What they want to do is they want to believe that the taxonomy will be real for a certain period until it comes to the created kinds. And these created kinds are the baramins from which everything else evolves. They don't accept evolution. They certainly don't call it evolution. They want to call it adaptation or something like that. But what they're talking about is they don't believe in gradual evolution over millions of years, but they do believe in a super duper hypercaffeinated electro mega evolution happening in about a century. From the moment everything gets off the ark, they have, instead of millions and millions of species, they have 1,400 original species. This is what they've arbitrarily determined. And that everything would then evolve from that point, like immediately. Instantly, everything procreates and turns into all kinds of different stuff. So you have like cats, for example. How many cats? Nobody knows. But because we call them cats, we could call a cat kind, right? They're all cats. That's a kind, right? The cats are also carnivores. No, we can't go too far. We have to arbitrarily stop. So how many cats were there? We have ancient Egyptian artifacts from just about the time of the flood, or immediately thereafter, what the time that they predict for the flood, where you have depictions of lions and house cats. So that's Panthera and Felis, you know, two big orders of cats. And they're already there like 100 years after the flood. So this is very, very fast. So And that's how they can reduce the millions of known species to a few hundred and still fit them on the ark. So at some point, they can't find these barements to show how we can determine them, how we can verify that these are the barements, that these are the original created kinds. And the reason that they can't is because, of course, they don't exist. But they're not going to admit that. If these barements did exist, and why is it the Bible names birds as a kind, but then subdivides them into all sorts of birds? So what's a sort? What is a kind? Because it still doesn't say, right? How do you identify it? How many kinds of birds are there? Why aren't they all called the bird kind? And what about the, why are there multiple kinds within one kind? And what about the, I should have put some pictures up here, but you know, I'm sure you guys are aware, you've seen the images of the velociraptors, oviraptors, all these other dromaeosaurids completely covered in feathers, right? Have you guys seen these? Right, we now know that every dromaeosaur had feathers on it. I toured Noah's Ark with a representative of Answers in Genesis guiding me, and he showed me their velociraptors in the cage. And I had to say, where are the feathers? He's confused. Every dromaeosaur has feathers. He can't admit that they had feathers because that makes them birds. Why, yet another arbitrary classification. And now that we've got so many feathered dinosaurs, I have to wonder what kind of backflips are they doing? Are they just ignoring that these things even exist? So I explain all this to you to give you some idea of where scientists were in the Age of Enlightenment, because this is where we get, here we go. Carl Linn, Swedish botanist, better known by his Latin name, Carolus Linnaeus. Now, he did something that remarkably nobody had ever tried to do before, and this was to organize organisms according to their collective traits, according to the what they call the morphology, right? Now, this systematic classification distinguished bats from birds and whales from fish. And then later, when they found fossil forms like pterosaurs and ichthyosaurs, it also distinguished, because of course they would have classified these as a bird and as a fish based on what they do, not what they are. But you scratch the surface, you see really what it is, that this is not a bird and this is not a fish. And one of the laws of evolution is that the more distantly related two organisms are, the deeper down their similarities will be, because all of evolution is superficial similarities being slowly compiled atop successive tiers of fundamental similarity. So the further apart they are, the further down you'll have to dig. You won't have to go far at all to realize that's not a bat and that's not a fish, but you'll have to go a little further to realize how close either one is to lizards, or that they are both reptiles. Okay, so, and that they both came from something that looked very much like a lizard. Now, creationists typically criticize evolution on the assertion that no transitional fossils have ever been found, even though we now know of hundreds of distinct examples according to the strictest definition of that word. However, none of these were known in Darwin's day, and Darwin said so, that in his time that transitional species either hadn't yet been identified or hadn't been identified as such. Maybe they had something that had been discovered, but people didn't realize it, you know, what its significance was. But he predicted that there would be transitional fossil species found in the future. But if he didn't have any in his time, then how did he know that they would be found ever? Why would he have, what reason would he have to think that if they've never found one yet? And it turns out to be the systematic classification of life. This is how he directed to evolution. This is how he predicted there would be transitions. This is famously known as Darwin's only drawing depicting the evolutionary tree of life as he envisioned it. This drawing did not, it appears in his notes, it did not make it in his book, but this drawing did. And can you, there's going to be a lot of images that are kind of this hard to see. Can you guys all see this? You see lines? Okay, good. Because if you can't, lie to me, because I can't change it now. It's too late. All right, so Darwin's examination, he did a decade of study after he came back, after he realized evolution, before he did his publication. He invested more than a decade of his life to comparative anatomy and studying the morphology and development and everything else of different organisms to make sure that his theory was robust and strong before he ever published it. And his comparisons revealed to him the same thing that Linnaeus saw too. Linnaeus was in a quandary because he was a Christian, and he had no way of explaining what he found. He was a century before Darwin. He had no concept of evolution. It was believed that species were immutable, that you could find new variations in a given species. You could crossbreed two closely related ones and get a hybrid, but there was no way of creating new taxa. Species were considered to be immutable. So how do you explain this? Why did he find a taxonomic tree of life just in the classification of life forms? He found nested hierarchies where instead of finding the created kind, and maybe originally you would think that there would be only a few created kinds. You know, God created camels and zebras and, you know, very, very simple, right? Because most people's idea of the animals is limited kind of to the animals they've seen around them, you know, until recent times. You know, when people started going to different continents and seeing things they'd never seen before, that was kind of impressive. They didn't used to know about things like leopards when you grew up in North America and so forth. So what he's finding is categories within categories. Like every clade that that concept hadn't come up with, hadn't come up in the speech yet. A clade is a classification that includes all of its descendants, which didn't exist in his time. I jumped ahead of myself. My apologies. How do I jump back? I don't want to get ahead and get confusing. What he found was all of his groups by the various names, you know, phylogeny, genus, kingdom, order, that he arbitrarily came up with for these. He came up with like 7. He had no idea how many there are. Neither do you, but you'll get an idea in a moment. Every one of them was like a Russian Matryoshka doll. So there's another category within that category, within that category, within that category. But what's weirder is there's not just one. There's at least 2, sometimes 5. You dump out every doll, there's 3 more, right? They're all part of this, and then they have descendants that are similarly delineated. So he had no way of explaining this. And it wasn't until Darwin made his famous trip around the world and started seeing things that his neighbors had never heard of, right? Seeing things that most people were not aware of. You know, they're aware of only of the animals that they see around them. They're not aware of this great variety that they've seen around the world. He literally went around the world for this. And in the Galapagos, famously, he happened across a collection of birds. I mean, he's just picking out different birds he's putting them in some kind of a preservation. He's not keeping them alive. So he's keeping all these little dead, dried out birds, mummified. And he brings them all back to the UK, which wasn't the UK at the time. But anyway, a trained ornithologist was actually the one that came to Darwin and said, you know what, these are not just a random assortment of birds that you thought they were. These are all finches. They're all variations of the same thing. And Darwin realized that each of these birds was a different variation of the bird from the mainland. And it was correct, they were all finches. And so what he had seen was that different species no longer interbreed with each other. They're completely genetically distinct, and yet the new species are clearly being derived from an ancestral species stock. It's a species level. I mean, we've seen lots of, you know, interbreeding of pigeons and dogs and sheep and cattle and things like that. So he knew that this kind of mutation in biology was possible, but only at that level. He'd never seen it at the species level. And here we had proof that it's happening at the species level. So if it happens with species of birds, why not families of birds? Why not families of everything? So Darwin went back to Systema Naturae, which was written by Carolus Linnaeus in the 1700s, armed with this new information. He sees how these birds are put together, and he's seeing a pattern now very similar to what Carolus Linnaeus had discovered himself. And suddenly, all of these nested hierarchies, once Darwin would realize that there's a process by which life can evolve, that connected all of the hierarchies that made such a mystery for Linnaeus. Suddenly, these nested hierarchies made sense. Now, this image, by the way, comes from the Arizona Tree of Life Project. This was the most successful, currently the only, I think, successful project to map the entire phylogenetic tree of life as a navigable online encyclopedia. But it's out of date. It's out of funding. What had happened was that there was a team of scientists, basically PhDs, were put together to build essentially a website. And that, you don't hire PhDs to do webmasters. it's a little more expensive than it needs to be. And from what I've heard, I can't confirm, but there was a bit of politicking going on, and then there was some financial issues, and so this site, which was a wonderful site, ran out of funding around 2000 before they had completed the Human Genome Project. So there are a number of corrections that need to be done to this. It's still a brilliant site, but there's a lot of things wrong with it that need to be fixed. It is no longer peer-reviewed, which it once was. Okay, so it was a peer-reviewed resource. There's another one that was similar to it called paleos.com, I think it is. It was brilliant. It was put together by a half a dozen amateurs that were just into this sort of thing, and they made this massive, beautiful site that concerned paleofauna. I mean, rich volumes of paleofauna. So for things, you would find these things on this one website that you wouldn't know about unless you worked in a paleo lab. If you were not a professional paleontologist, you would never have heard of most of these things, because most people, what they know about paleofauna is limited to the few plastic pieces in the prehistoric playset down at the grocery store. They think that's it. Right? They have no idea. There's 750 species of dinosaurs, just of dinosaurs, and that's just one subgroup. You know, everybody thinks that plesiosaurs are dinosaurs and pterosaurs are dinosaurs and woolly mammoths are dinosaurs, but it's not that way. Dinosaurs are just one little subgroup. And then I'm going to show you some slides from another project, one we're working on. This is from the Phylogeny Explorer project. Okay, so let me catch up where I am. There's different ways of rendering this, and we've chosen one that was very organic. I did a video called The 10th Foundational Falsehood of Creationism, where I did an old Windows-based Windows Explorer program, if anybody even remembers that anymore, because that was like a decade ago when that still existed. And it was showing how these different file folders, you click into one and you open up, and everything that's in that file folder is still in the parent folder. So it was one way, a good way of explaining how things don't turn into something else. The creationist argument against evolution is, how come we never see one thing turn into a completely different thing? Because that violates the laws of evolution. That's why you don't see that. You can't outgrow your ancestry. All of evolution is you're just a modified version of whatever your parents were. So, shocking fact. Yeah, somebody showed a slide earlier that says, well, if we came from apes, why are there still apes? Right? Why are we still apes? Is the question. If we didn't come from apes, why are we apes? Now, right now. And, well, I didn't come from no monkey. Well, then why are you still a monkey? Right now. And I mean that literally. We humans are a classification of, we are a member of the super hominoidea, which is ape. Literally. Apes are a subset of Catarrhini, which is old world monkeys. We are monkeys. Now, there are people will say that no, monkeys and apes are separate. They come from a common ancestor. The common ancestor was a monkey. Modern cercopiths, okay, we didn't evolve from modern cercopiths, but there's another group that is now known from fossils, and a couple of them are back there, or at least one. Aegyptopithecus is one of the fossils that they have there. Aegyptopithecus was classified at, or described as, by paleoprimatologists as being a very monkey-like, or no, excuse me, an ape-like monkey. And this was succeeded by Proconsul, which was described as a monkey-like ape. So paleoprimatologists describe all of the ancestors for Catarrhini, the old world monkeys, and then the ancestors for both the old world monkeys and new world monkeys was also a monkey. Right? It's a colloquial term. It's not a scientific term, but it's still applicable. You're still a monkey. You still have all the classifications, all the criteria necessary. Fingernails, fingerprints, two pectoral mammae, right? Have to do that quickly before anybody gets their camera out. So the type of teeth that we have, the type, there's so many different features. In one of my books, I only have one book, and I don't have it here. I apologize. I didn't have, I was sold out. And I apologize, I don't have any here like the other authors do. But it is available on Amazon. The Foundational Falsehoods of Creationism. In the 10th chapter, which was also that video, I go into, oh no, that was the 9th. Yeah, never mind, doesn't matter. I go into a long list of what are the criteria required to classify us as primates. And then you take that long list of what makes us a primate, and you add to that to what makes us a monkey and what makes us an ape and so forth. You just keep adding onto the list. And you can also add a loss of things. So like a loss of traits can also be. One of the things that we have in common with the other monkeys, for example, is a loss of the ability to synthesize vitamin C. We have a number of other deletions that are interesting in our genome. We have one of the reasons that our brains are so large, this encephalization of the brain, comes from a defect, a dysfunction in a monkey gene that was a tumor suppressor gene. It doesn't work in us. So if you want to talk about creation and you want to talk about intelligent design, what's the purpose of us having a whole bunch of dysfunctional monkey genes? Why do we have them and they're broken? So no attempt to explain that. So anyway, I'm going a bit of a rant. I'll try to get back to where I was supposed to. I had a whole thing written out here. Okay, so let's see. Which one are we looking at? This is metazoa, is it? Yeah, yes. Good. All right, metazoa is the Latin name for animalia. They don't say animalia anymore. The definition for metazoa, for what an animal is a multicellular organism that has an internal digestive tract. Now, a multicellular eukaryote. People talk about unicellular animals, single-celled animals. There's no such thing. By definition, animals have to be multicellular. Now, Anthony van Leeuwenhoek, I try to say that name right, discovered, before they even discovered that there was an ancient world before this one, which was quite a revelation for these scientists, Leeuwenhoek discovered another hidden world inside a drop of water. And he originally thought that what he was looking at were all the animate things he thought were animals. Just like, you know, normal animals, but smaller. And some of them were. But he discovered that a great many more, most of them, in fact, were something completely different. And that they were plants, that what they thought were plants because they were green or they looked plant-like or they were stalky or whatever, that turned out not to be plants. Mold and algae turns out not to be plants. So they had to broaden their categories quite a bit. And you see where metazoa is now? That's a subcategory for all these other eukaryotes, most of which are neither plants nor animals nor fungus nor whatever. Most of these are protists, which really ought to be at like a dozen categories by itself. But that's not all that Leeuwenhoek, or I'm not even going to try to do that name anymore. That's not all he discovered. He also discovered bacteria, which was another even bigger hidden world. Amazing that they never knew about this at all, right? Bacteria was discovered to be more complicated than what he thought in 1974. And I remember when they did this, when they discovered archaea, which was a subgroup of bacteria that was so genetically distinct that they couldn't consider it a subgroup anymore. They considered it a sister group, and so they recategorized. And archaea and bacteria are separate categories. Every other form of life, every plant, every animal, every fungus, everything is in eukarya. And so that we have three domains. One of them, you can divide that into two categories with bacteria and everything else, but there are three domains, two different types of bacteria, sort of, and then all of us. Now, if you're going to categorize any collective, you must first define the grouping by the total tally of traits that are held by everything that's already universally accepted to be part of that set, and not make special exceptions for certain ones. And the only way to objectively categorize all sorts of life is by their common characters. And let's see, I want to get to, what's the next one? Metazoa to deuterostomia. Let's see if I can do a lecture on this, a short one. Okay, no, this will be too confusing. Starting with metazoa, you know what the animal definition is? Deuterostomia. Each one of these clades, everything that you see named up here, begins a whole category where everything that evolves from here is still going to be part of this group. It'll never change so much that it's not part of that group anymore. This, by the way, is periphera. These are sponges. So everything after that is a sponge. Every other kind of animal, eumetazoa, the new animals. And so continuing off of that. Now, deuterostomia, that's our group. This is typically called the higher animals by some people. Again, not a scientific term. What is the classification? It's not just your morphology that determines what your classification is. It's not just your physical traits. It's also your development, right? So here's a developmental change in deuterostomes. All animals, as they develop, would become from a zygote state, you develop a little ball of cells called a blastopore. And the first feature that the blastopore develops is a hole that starts in one end and comes out the other. Now, in most animals, that hole is a mouth that connects through to become an anus on the other side. except in higher animals like us. It starts anus first and then connects to the mouth. So that's the first feature to develop. So there is actually a point wherein we are literally nothing but assholes. To go a little further with this, identifying these classifications, let's see. Deuterostomes, you know what those are, and let me get back on stage like I should be. My arms aren't long enough otherwise. Chordata, you have the beginnings of a spinal cord, right? Not necessarily a spinal cord, but close to it. That's the classification here. Olfactors, I think that's where you have nostrils and scent capacity, right? Then craniate, what does craniate mean? Gotcha. You got a cranium. And notice that you don't ever have it in another order. You don't have, you know, things that have a skull but don't have a spinal cord, right? You have the spinal cord first, and then you get the vertebrate after you get the cranium. It's always in this order. Now, not everything in this class is this, or let me put it another way. Not all birds are ducks, but all ducks are birds, right? It works that way. So the classification system indicates another tree of life. And this is, again, not just according to its morphology, but also because of its development. You trace this through the fossil record, you get the same thing again. You get, when you look at the embryological development, the development of from the embryo, you again see a degree of recapitulation. Were you not following the adult stages like had been suggested famously in the 19th century, but you do get a pattern of development that does show some recapitulation here. Just not the way that it was originally proposed. Let's see, the next one. You're beginning to show, just to remind you, just in the classification of life forms, we are seeing a tree of life develop and showing evolutionary stages. For example, we start with nathostomata. These are fish that have jaws. And gets a little bit more complicated until you get up to the top where we have fish that have fingers. And so now we have fish that have feet and fingers and lungs and at the top that aren't even fish anymore. And since I said you can't stop being what your parents were, the word fish has been rendered meaningless in cladistics. There's not a consistent classification for it. The same goes for reptile. The word reptile effectively means nothing anymore, as we'll see in a moment. And because the classification of a reptile is a cold-blooded, scaly thing with claws, right, that lays eggs, except that we know things that are universally accepted to be reptiles that don't lay eggs, that give live birth, that don't have claws, that don't have feet, they don't have four limbs, and they're still considered tetrapods, because the loss of a trait can also lead to the classification. Is everybody following me?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, I just feel like I'm ranting. All right, so tetrapod. This is where you have a four-legged animal that is skeletally adapted for life on land. That's the classification there. And we saw how we got this as a subclassification of what we used to call fish. And then we get up to amniote. Amniote is where you develop in amnion, amniotic fluid, right? So this is another developmental stage. Going a little further, we'll see what do we got about here. Okay. Yeah. Now we have an important division. Synapsids and diapsids. And as you can see in the fossil displays that are in the back, the synapsids are identified by having a single temporal fenestra, which in humans is closed, but you can still see the shape of this hole that used to be in the skull, in the temple of our cranium as it is. Diapsids have two temporal fenestra. And the dinosaur fossils in the back there will show you. Like they have a Deinonychus and a Velociraptor back there that'll show it. And they also have next to those is a Dimetrodon, which is not a reptile in the cladistic or the traditional sense. It's a synapsid, so it only has the one hole in the side of the skull. I wanted to, this project, this is the Phylogeny Explorer project, and we'll explain a little bit more about this in a moment. This is where we want to map out the entire tree of life and not just have it be meaningless points of data with names. We want illustrations. Once the data is up sufficiently, we're going back and putting in detailed explanations, images, and so forth, so that when you hover over or just glide through this, you'll be able to see pictures to show you where you were at, so that you have got some clue in how to get through this. Through diapsids, I wanted to chart a course myself. I looked at the top archosauromorphs. You have reptiles are divided into lepidosaurs and archosaurs. And the really interesting stuff is in the archosaur area. When I took this screenshot, nobody had started to do dinosaurs yet. And I wanted to leave that for some of our other volunteers. I've got a couple dozen volunteers that have been adding data into this for free, right, just on their own time. And then we'll bring in other people. And what they're doing is they're following the cladograms that are already on Wikipedia, because all the Wikipedia cladograms have the scientific notations at the bottom. And then wherever we see a discrepancy, we have other backup sources that we go to compare. And then we have scientific references we go to compare if there's a problem with that. And then, as I said, we get to a certain point, it becomes peer-reviewed. We bring the scientists in themselves to maintain each of these clades. We're just trying to build up the data. We know there are some mistakes to be made, but it's a self-correcting process. And this is going to be a self-correcting system. So I didn't want to do dinosaurs. I wanted to let other people do dinosaurs. I made the mistake of doing pterosaurs because I happen to know that one. I wanted to do something simple. I wanted to do lizards, right? So in Lepidosauromorphs, we see squamata. Squamata is basically lizards. Just above that, you probably can't read it, Rhynchocephalia. That's the tuatara. Anybody heard of a tuatara? It's a very lizard-like thing from New Zealand. Yeah, everybody calls it a lizard. It's not a lizard. It's the last surviving species of what was used to be at least 50 examples of Rhynchocephalians from the fossil record. Again, nobody has any idea the volume of stuff that don't exist anymore. Right, that what we have on the planet now, the millions of species we have on the planet now, represents about 1% of the genera that used to be here. There were, as we have three different classifications of mammals, the marsupials, the placentals, that's us, you know, things that give live birth the regular way, and then we have the monotremes that lay the eggs, right? There used to be twice as many different orders of mammals than we have now. And some are known only from fossil fragments, but whole huge divisions. So getting into squamata, got to point this somewhere. All right, follow that where you can understand it. Let's say Toxifera, the second from the last. This is where we have the emergence of venom. And then this is not always consistent. You can also lose it again. Some genes, when you get to a close area of a division, the gene can start turning on and off. And some will come on again in a later generation. Pythonomorpha is interesting. At the top, you see Mosasauridae. Anybody know what a mosasaur is? Thank you. For those who do not, yeah, they are lizards. They're literally lizards. They're not dinosaurs. They're not sea monsters. But they could easily be mistaken for one. 40 to 60 feet long lizards that have paddles instead of feet. They live always in the ocean. And they were the apex predator during the Cretaceous. They're very closely related to snakes. Their closest living relative is the Komodo dragon and other lizards of that type. So following down to serpentes, obviously we're talking about snakes. And I just wanted to get a little bit, I made the most foolish mistake. I'm not going to do lizards or too many lizards. I'm just going to do snakes. That's all. So, Xenophyta, and I'm not even going to do that many snakes, because look how many different snakes. You don't know how many snakes you're looking at yet, but I'm about to show you. We'll just go to one superfamily, Colubridae, that down there at the bottom. One family, just so we can finally start to see the species. That's one superfamily. Did you see how many led up to this? So let's look at Colubridae. Narrow it down just a little bit. Now here you see what Linnaeus saw with species within a genus within a family. Right, that was his simple division, but he didn't have the knowledge or understanding. He didn't have the genetics. He didn't have the completed genomes that we can compare. He didn't have fossil records that we can compare. He didn't have any concept of evolution to know how much more broad it is than this. So let's select just this one, and I only suggest that one because I had one as a pet and I liked it. Mine was the top one. but this is a collection of pine snakes, gopher snakes, and bull snakes. I had a Sonoran gopher snake, a Sonoran bull snake. So that's five different species. Now, the people that want to argue against evolution want to believe that all of these came from one ancestor, that all of these came from one ancestor who was on Noah's Ark. And that all of these, which kinds are they? Where do the divisions for kinds begin? Right? Now, the interesting thing about this presentation is that I had to stop here because this is not the presentation I meant to give. The presentation I meant to give was where I reveal the website where you can go and look these up and see the pictures and read the data descriptions, because we're actually talking about an encyclopedia, not of the individual species, but of the value of the clades that we were talking about up to this point, what it means to be each clade. And so when you look, when you trace down your human evolutionary line, for example, you will see that you still are everything your ancestors were, with a couple of exceptions like Australopithecus, names that were invented before they had a monophyletic classification system, which is the transition to now, which makes a lot more sense. One of the conventions that we still have is when you get down to the species level, we don't go into the subspecies. That just gets too ridiculous. So with each of these species, we will, if you hover over the three dots, that's where you get the information over each one of them. And because that doesn't work on cell phones, we might have to make it so you click it instead. But this is where you find out what the common names are and what the subspecies are and any other interesting information. But the big pieces of information I wanted were from the clades. And as I said, I wanted to reveal the website, but a number of changes had happened. Now, I've been trying for 8 years to get funding for this, to get this underway. And I finally found an entrepreneur who said this would be a really good idea, and he wanted to put money into it. And he's put thousands of British pounds into it so far. And he says he doesn't regret that, but he's out for a bit. He hired an engineer that I did a video with to praise him for having created the first database for this. We thought it was done. Good. We started data entry. Oh, crap, it doesn't work. He didn't know the volume of the data that we were putting in. So we had one of those child spaghetti bridges we're trying to drive cars on, and it wasn't working. So we had another guy, something like a couple $1,000 a week, to design this new site. And he has all kinds of other pretty things he wants to do to it to make it more beautiful, make it more user-friendly. But, as I said, we've come to a monetary stop very, very recently, which was complicated by our being attacked online. We got some hacker issues and other things, so we had to put in some more securities. There are other securities that be built in. We didn't make our deadline for me to show the reveal. Maybe a month from now, but this is where I'm at. I was hoping that I would do this final reveal for you and show you where you can go to see this, and it's not yet available for the public yet. So I don't know, I have no idea how to end this presentation other than to say thank you.